As for the tribes, each has its tongue and its own way of calling things.
And they treat this part of the world just as they treat all others. Among ourselves, we've got to calling the place the Glimmerglass, seeing that its whole basin is so often hinged with pines cast upward to its face as if it would throw back the hills that hang over it. There is an outlet, I know, for all lakes have outlets, and the rock at which I am to meet Chingachgook stands near an outlet. Has that no colony name yet? In that particular, they've got the advantage of us having one end, and that the biggest, in their own keeping. They've given it a name which has found its way up to its source. Names naturally working upstream. No doubt, Deerslayer, you've seen the Susquehanna down in the Delaware country?
That I have, and hunted along its banks 100 times. That and this are the same in fact, and I suppose the same in sound. I am glad they've been compelled to keep the red men's name, for it would be too hard to rob them of both land and name.
Deerslayer made no answer, but he stood leaning on his rifle, gazing at the view which so much delighted him. The reader is not to suppose, however, that it was the picturesque alone which so strongly attracted his attention. The spot was very lovely, of a truth, and it was then seen in one of its most favorable moments, the surface of the lake being as smooth as glass and as limpid as pure air, throwing back the mountains, clothed in dark pines, along the whole of its eastern boundary, the points thrusting forward their trees even to nearly horizontal lines, while the bays were seen glittering through an occasional arch beneath, left by a vault fretted with branches and leaves. It was the air of deep repose, the solitudes that spoke of scenes and forests untouched by the hands of man. The reign of nature, in a word, that gave so much pure delight to one of his habits and turn of mind. Still, he felt, though it was unconsciously, like a poet also. If he found a pleasure in studying this large and to him unusual opening into the mysteries and forms of the woods, as one is gratified in getting broader views of any subject that has long occupied his thoughts, he was not insensible to the innate loveliness of such a landscape neither, but felt a portion of that soothing of the spirit which is a common attendant of a scene so thoroughly pervaded by the holy cairn of nature.
Chapter 3. Come, shall we go and kill us venison? And yet it irks me, the poor dappled foals, being native burghers of this desert city, should, in their own confines, with forked heads, have their round haunches gored. As You Like It. Act 2, Scene 1, Lines 21-25. Hurry Harry thought more of the beauties of Judith Hutter than of those of the Glimmerglass and its accompanying scenery. As soon as he had taken a sufficiently intimate survey of Floating Tom's implements, therefore, he summoned his companion to the canoe, that they might go down the lake in quest of the family. Previously to embarking, however, Hurry carefully examined the whole of the northern end of the water with an indifferent ship's glass that formed a part of Hutter's effects. In this scrutiny, no part of the shore was overlooked, the bays and points in particular being subjected to a closer inquiry than the rest of the wooded boundary.
"'Tis as I thought,' said Hurry, laying aside the glass. "'The old fellow is drifting about the south end this fine weather, and has left the castle to defend itself. Well, now we know that he is not up this away. 'Twill be but a small matter to paddle down and hunt him up in his hiding-place.'
"'Does Master Hutter think it necessary to burrow on this lake?' inquired Deerslayer, as he followed his companion into the canoe. "'To my eye it is such a solitude as one might open his whole soul in, and fear no one to disarrange his thoughts or his worship. You forget your friends the Mingos, and all the French savages. Is there a spot on earth, Deerslayer, to which them disquiet rogues don't go? Where is the lake, or even the deer lick, that the blackguards don't find out, and having found out, don't sooner or later discolor its water with blood? I hear no good character of them, certainly, friend Hurry, though I've never been called on yet to meet them, or any other mortal, on the warpath. I dare to say that such a lovely spot as this would not be likely to be overlooked by such plunderers, for, though I've not been in the way of quarreling with them tribes myself, the Delawares give me such an account of 'em that I've pretty much set 'em down, in my own mind, as thorough miscreants. You may do that with a safe conscience, or, for that matter, any other savage you may happen to meet.